Start the meeting, please, and I welcome you all to this, the 31st meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members, welcome our witnesses who will give evidence shortly, and can I welcome visitors in the gallery? And can I remind everyone, please, to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones or other electronic devices. We have apologies this morning from Patrick Harvey, who is unwell. Item two on the agenda. Can I ask if members are content to delegate to the convener responsibility for arranging for the SPCB to pay under Rule 12.4.3 any expenses of witnesses in the evidence sessions on the future of oil and gas in Scotland and renewable energy in Scotland?
Agreed.
Is that agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. Item three on the agenda. We are continuing to take evidence in relation to our look at oil and gas in Scotland. And I'd like to welcome our first panel of witnesses this morning. We're joined by Deirdre, Michie, who's Chief Executive, and Mike Tholen, who is Economic Director of Oil and Gas UK. Welcome to you both. And we're also joined by James Bream, who is Research and Policy Director at Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce. Welcome. Thank you for coming along. Now, before we get into questions, I think, Deirdre, Michie, you were hoping to say something by way of an introductory statement.
Yes, Convener, thank you very much, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We really appreciate being invited to give evidence today. And so what I'd like to say is just set some context before we get into Q's and A's. So Oil and Gas UK, Mike and I work for Oil and Gas UK. We're the leading trade association for the offshore oil and gas industry. We're not for profit. We have over 520 members across the whole of the UK. A lot of them, 85% of them, are actually from the supply chain. So we cover the whole range from your big operators through to your smaller operators and right the way through the supply chain. You will all be quite familiar, I think, with the oil and gas industry, but I think it's always good to reinforce what an amazing industry we have in the UK. You know, we continue to support hundreds of thousands of skilled jobs. We have contributed to the security of energy supply in this country for many years. If you think about it, the lights haven't gone off since the 70s. And in terms of investment and taxes that have been paid, we've paid billions of pounds to the Treasury and made huge investments in this country over the years. So the economic value of our contribution is significant. We've seen record investment over the last three to four years. We were up £14 billion in terms of capital investment in 2014, you know, with big projects coming through. So the upside of that is the big projects coming through. The downside of that has been we've also then seen an acceleration and escalation of costs. And also we've seen efficiency dropping in our industry over the years. And of course, that's been compounded by the very sharp and now sustained drop in the oil price, which is really challenging our industry at the moment. So as an industry, we are very focused on turning things around. We're concentrating on the areas we can influence, and that is the cost piece, and that is the efficiency piece, and looking to make improvements there. And we are seeing costs reducing, and we are seeing efficiencies, you know, improving as we go through. And we're working very cooperatively with Treasury, with the regulator, and with governments generally in terms of really trying to turn this industry around. So the downside is that we're seeing job losses as a result, and we obviously recognise this is a very significant issue and a very personal issue for people who have been made redundant or at risk of being made redundant at at an individual level and at a family level. And we recognise that and are looking to work very constructively and positively in that area. But as I said, there is an upside to the actions we're taking in terms of production actually increasing for the first time in 15 years. We are seeing costs coming down, and we are seeing production efficiency improving. So we are going through extremely challenging times as an industry, and we expect those challenging times to continue. You know, we're not seeing that likely to change very much in 2016, but we are very focused and committed as an industry to continuing to ensure that we have a sustainable industry that can come through these difficult times and continue to provide the economic value to Scotland and the UK going forward. So appreciate being asked today, appreciate your interest, and obviously asking for your support as we go through these difficult times. Convener, thank you.
Thank you very much for that introduction. I think you've touched on a number of issues around taxation, the regulatory impact, what impact on the wider economy, question of the cost base, health and safety issues, which I think we'll want to pick up in the course of the questioning. We've got, as I said, about an hour and 10 minutes now for questions. I'd ask members if they would keep their questions short and to the point. It'd be helpful if members, incidentally, would address their questions at a particular panel member, and then if you want to come in and respond to a point addressed to somebody else, if you just catch my eye, I'll bring you in as best as I can as the time allows. And responses that are as short and to the point would be helpful to get through the range of topics you want to cover in the time available to us. I wonder if I could just start off and pick up on a point you mentioned, and maybe address this initially to yourself, James Bream, about the wider economic impact. You provided us with the oil and gas survey that was done by Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce by University of Strathclyde, looking at the broader impact. We've already heard some evidence about the broader impact of the decline on the economy in Aberdeen and the Northeast. Can you just give us briefly your assessment of the knock-on effect of the decline in the oil price and what impact that's having on the local economy in Aberdeen?
I think obviously the context to start this is the numbers that are out there in terms of jobs. Commend Oil and Gas UK for having a go at assessing that, because it's extremely difficult to do. We've, I suppose, tracked redundancies company by company, and to a certain extent you can do that. Below a certain level, it's not possible because they don't have to be made publicly available. What we do know is in the last year from our survey that around 14% of the workforce has been lost in the operating community. I think we need to remember that that started in 2014, so that 14% isn't the full picture, and it will continue to next year. We also then have the supply chain impact, and easily you can track about 8,000 jobs there. So quite quickly, without doing any clever maths, adding those together with some very small multiplier impact, you get to a figure in the last year of somewhere in the region of 25,000 to 30,000. So the 65,000 figure, is entirely feasible, even if you take a ban. Now, what you haven't seen, I was interested to read the Spice report, is a real impact yet on unemployment data. There's been a nudging up in the claimant count in the Northeast. I think at this point it's too early to use that as a real indicator. You're seeing people on gardening leave being made redundant on packages, unlikely to claim, people relocating back, perhaps expats. So that's a pretty blunt tool. We've started to look at data around the Northeast to get a bit more of a feel for activity levels. A few things I'd just flag up. Commercial property, certainly a softening of the office market, quite a significant one. More workshop and shed type space is holding up. Hotels, as you've probably heard this in other areas, but significant fall in occupancy from somewhere near 80% to about 66% year on year, significant drop there. Average room rates also falling from about £100 a night to £75. Houses, we've seen this time last year, about 88% of properties that went to market were selling. We're down to 73% now, so that's a real fall. And we've also had a look at jobs. So we've spoken to some recruitment consultancies. The number of jobs being posted with them has halved since this time last year. And I think the last one that is that people have talked it in an anecdotal way, but we've approached some of the car dealerships as well. Their order book this time last year was healthy but falling, with some of the kind of higher end looking at about 30 orders a month, and literally there is nothing in the order book for the year ahead. So I think you can look at the lag in the government data, and that can be explained away in some respects. And I guess the question that we're asking ourselves is, we're now starting to see this impact ripple out, and it's a question of how long does this softening go on? And we don't know that, but what we do know is that it'll certainly continue through 2016, and we've forecast more redundancies in a report.
I'm actually going to ask you that very question that you finished on. I mean, are we through the worst, or do you sense there is more to come in terms of redundancies, or is it so dependent upon the oil price it's impossible to make any forward projections?
I think we could probably both answer this question. I think the first question is it through the worst in terms of production and cost efficiency and these kind of things? The question you're asking me, I guess, is about redundancies. I think where we are is that we've seen a real hard and sharp reaction, which has been necessary. I think what we'll see in the next year is a slowing of the percentage rate fall in redundancies than there has been in the last year. However, that comes clearly on the back of an extremely difficult year. So what's left behind is a situation where those still remaining in businesses will feel more impacted. It's difficult to retain morale when you're going through these multiple processes. So I think we're not at the bottom in terms of the reduction in employment, that's for sure.
Deirdre, Michie, have you got a view on this?
Well, I think I'll pass to Mike because I'll make a comment, Mike.
Yeah, thanks. I probably concur with what James and Deirdre said. What we're seeing is not just an oil price impact. What we're seeing is companies respond to having less money to invest in new opportunities, and they're trying to curtail the expenditure on running their businesses because they're under such big duress from the fall in oil price. And inevitably, there will be further job losses, not least as the outlook remains much lower than anticipated even in the spring of this year.
Okay. So in terms of where we are going forward on redundancies, have you got any indication of where you think that the industry is going? Will we see more in the course of the next year?
I think we've got to calibrate the picture again in the spring. What we're seeing now is companies are putting together their plans for the coming year. We ourselves are working with companies to get an overall picture of that investment outlook and spend outlook. And hopefully by the early spring, we'll have a good picture on investment, what the opportunities are looking like. And it's really as a result of that, we'll get a much better thermometer of the outlook for the next year.
Okay, thank you. I've got two other issues I want to raise, but I've got three members who've caught my eye. I want to come in with supplementary, specifically on the economic impact. I'll start with Lewis MacDonald.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm interested in the evidence that you've presented thus far. I guess there's a question about how far the economic impact goes along the supply chain. Clearly, we've seen large-scale job losses from the operators and major contractors. What is a little bit more difficult to get a handle on, because I don't think there are any government figures, is on the impact further up the supply chain and also beyond the northeast, or clearly in the northeast, but also beyond the northeast. And it'd be interesting to have comments from.
We get approached from around the UK to ask what's going on, because clearly, you know, the supply chain is a UK supply chain. So recently we've been approached by companies in Fife who've had to reduce their number of working days in the week. We've had comment and questions from companies in Birmingham who sell fasteners for the oil and gas industry. So the impact has been felt throughout the UK, and activity levels are now, I think, being felt further down the supply chain. I suppose what I would say is that it's an observation from visiting companies is that sometimes the smaller companies can be a little bit more fleet of foot in terms of diversification, in terms of moving into different markets than some of the larger ones. But I think we're now at the stage where we're starting to see that ripple effect is the lack of activity in terms of investment or the fallen investment starts to pass its way through.
So could I build on that? You know, so it's absolutely, I completely agree with that. I think there's no one part of the industry that's taking the brunt of it. This is across the whole piece, and I think that's a very important thing to remind ourselves of. I think James makes a really important point about the diversification piece. So we have a very strong supply chain that's, you know, rooted in the UK, and but have a very strong export base. So one of the things we need to be thinking about as we go forward is supporting them, making sure they anchor themselves here, but then are looking to diversify and to improve their export opportunities, because that's something as we move into the future, we need to ensure we have a strong supply base that's anchored here, but with a very strong export market.
And specifically, would it be fair to say that there's as well as clearly production of oil and services in the general sense, is there a particular impact on manufacturing in Scotland and in other parts of the supply chain? In other words, companies which are making things for the industry and don't necessarily have other customers ready to hand.
I think in the what we've seen hitherto with some, I guess if you want to call them cycles, I don't think I'd just call this a cycle, is that international markets have been a bit of a safe haven, so we've not seen confidence falling in the international markets. This time, because we have our own challenges in the region, but there is a global picture here. There is challenges in international markets, so the manufacturers and exporters are finding life more difficult. However, you know, there are always new markets and new opportunities, and I think we've got an £11 billion supply chain in Scotland, larger in the UK. And I think proportionately over the next couple of years, we'll probably see the proportion of export and international business grow from the record 50% we've had in 2013 to a greater figure. And I guess the trick is, how do we secure that UK cluster and not lose it to overseas markets as we see, you know, the UKCS continue to operate in a different way than it has in the past.
Thank you very much, Convener. Obviously, I hear what you're saying in terms of some of the gloomier predictions, but I noticed that in your report for the Chambers on page 7, when you asked employers in the next 12 months what they anticipate employment numbers to be, 44% said they anticipated employment to remain the same, and 19% thought it would increase. Does that give grounds for optimism? 63% either think it will remain the same or increase.
Room for optimism in the world. We should all be hopeful people. Yeah. I think that where we look is that the aggregate level, and it's the aggregates that we tend to look, when we've looked at the numbers that people are reporting, and this is based on, I guess, their year-ahead budgets, the overall number will be a decline in employment. You know, I think we're certain about that. But what that doesn't tell you is the story of individual companies, some of which are, you know, doing well, succeeding, and will continue to grow. So, yeah, every single company has a different story, but the aggregate one is that I think the year ahead is going to be extremely tough.
So can I build on that? I think that's right. It depends where you are in the kind of life cycle. So if you're at the front of it in terms of drilling and exploration, then it's really tough. But if you're working on production and OPEX-related activities, then your order book is probably more likely to be a positive one. And then that obviously gets reflected down the supply chain. So it's a mixed picture. But going back to what James was saying, you know, it is a mixed picture also in terms of the optimism, because there's some really good stuff that's happening as well in terms of companies turning themselves around and improving their efficiency. So getting that balance right in terms of recognising we are going through really challenging times, there are, you know, tough decisions to be made, but there is good stuff happening as well. We have to get that balance right in terms of how we, you know, so we don't lose confidence in the industry going forward.
Yeah. My other supplementary question, if you don't mind, Convener, was you mentioned earlier about the record levels of investment in 2014. When will we see a payback for that investment?
So you are already beginning to see that over the last 5 years. There's been a very strong investment since 2009-10 it started to pick up. And in 2009, that saw the sanction of the Lag and Tormore field, a massive development west of Shetlands. That is coming on stream in the near future. There are already production events coming on stream, which is, I think, going to push production this year up by about 8 to 10% compared with a year ago. So despite inevitably the gloom on what's going on, production is improving, that is responding to investment, operating efficiencies are getting better, so even in down times we are doing better where we can.
And that west of Shetland field that you mentioned, do you know when that's going to be coming into production?
I think that is in the autumn this year, but I miss sorry the spring this year, coming year, but I missed the exact date on this one.
And will that make a significant difference?
It will. It's one of a number of fields, so there's a lot of activity west of Shetlands, the Clare field coming on next year, Quad 204, Schiehallion, a lot of developments there. We have stuff in the Central North Sea as well. So, you know, there are still things going on. It is not a completely empty order book and not a completely empty industry.
So there are grounds for optimism there?
Yes. Certainly.
Robertson.
Approach we're taking this morning. Morning. James, maybe I could focus my supplementary to you initially. Did you factor in the impact on the austerity programme that the rest of the country is being impacted? I mean, because, you know, we're focusing here on obviously the energy sector, oil and gas, and obviously there have been redundancies. We're talking about cost efficiencies, cost efficiency improvements, and using lots of different terms like that. But when you were coming forward with your report, do we factor in the impact of the other areas of austerity?
There's probably a simple way to answer that, and it's the oil and gas report itself looks at the sector as reported by business,
yeah.
And businesses within the sector. I think one thing I would highlight is that obviously there's a number of wider streams of work that are going on in the northeast, which potentially are extremely exciting. We're looking at some new arrangements in terms of economic development, some of that being driven by the private sector. You'll all be very aware and supportive, I hope, of the city region deal negotiations that are taking place at the moment. And for that, it's really based on, I suppose, what is being called a renaissance scenario, which when we look at other cities around the world who are dominated by a single sector, often they decline or they go through a renaissance. And I think part of that renaissance in the Northeast can be driven through technology, innovation, diversification, internationalisation. And a lot of that's the focus of the city deal, but also other sectors, food and drink, tourism. And a lot of that are based around things that are important for the oil and gas industry as well, such as making the Northeast an attractive place to do business and make sure it's well connected. So I think you're right to, in some ways, highlight austerity. I'd probably rather highlight the opportunity around some of these things.
Which is fantastic, James. I think my point was the Northeast actually protected from the austerity to some extent? Was there a sort of bubble within the Northeast that the impact of the rest of the country was having through the austerity programme? There was a degree of it didn't really impact in the Northeast until the cost efficiencies, until the oil price fell, and then we started seeing it?
We did some analysis looking at some European data, and between about, I think it was 2002, this was a few years ago, 2002 and 2012, yeah. We were one of the highest performing regions in the whole of Europe, metropolitan regions. So not only did we, were we counter-cyclical in the UK, we were actually counter-cyclical across the whole of Europe over that period of, as people call it, the Great Recession. So I think there was a lot that protected us, and clearly, Mike's raised the point of record investment. That record investment happened over a period where the rest of the country was under significant strain. So I think we have weathered that particular storm, and because we're counter-cyclical, we'll now go through some of our own challenges. But again, I think I would say that I think we're well up to that with the right support.
Good. Thanks. Welcome back to all questions.
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple of questions myself, and then I'll bring in other members. You mentioned diversification. Maybe start with yourself, James Bream, because I was looking at your oil and gas survey, and you have a comment on page 14 where you've asked firms' expectations of whether they might become more involved in unconventional oil and gas activities, looking at the opportunity to diversify there. And I think you say 67%, two-thirds of all firms expect to see an increase in their involvement in this area in the medium term. Is this an area that you see there being opportunities? And if so, do you think the Scottish Government's moratorium on fracking is helpful or unhelpful in this regard?
Thanks for that. This is the first time I've asked this question. So what I would say is that the response needs
some more analysis in the future, and we'll probably ask the question in a slightly different way, because this could be a reflection of international markets. Already there are a high number of supply chain companies, particularly as well as operators, involved in this internationally. So it might be more a reflection of that. Obviously, the activity in the UK in this area seems to be a little bit further away than immediate opportunities that exist in international markets. So I think if companies were looking at the immediate opportunities, they probably wouldn't be looking in the UK as a way to really substantially change their business base. And that, by that, I mean supply chain companies.
So the opportunities are not in the UK, that at the moment they're elsewhere?
I think they look limited in the medium term. Okay, in the UK.
I don't know. Do you have a view on this from oil and gas UK?
As James mentioned, diversification is something that all companies clearly will look for. They have great expertise and great capability in the UK, and that made in the UK brand is something that they're going to obviously stand on the best they can for this downturn.
Okay, so are we being held back in the UK from progressing this agenda and creating jobs here?
So could you clarify what you mean behind that question?
Mr. Bream has just said that the opportunities are out with the UK. I'm wondering why we're not seeing more opportunities in this field in the UK, given the skills clearly are transferable from the offshore industry to the onshore industry.
At the point that we're at in the UK, other people are already delivering unconventional activities, and we're not yet in the UK. So if I were a supply chain company, I would be looking at the immediate markets, which are there and ripe to exploit. I think we're, as you all know, going through our own regulatory processes at the moment, and as and when those conclude, I'm sure companies will start to see opportunities here.
Okay, let me ask you another easy question then. We've heard a lot in recent months about campaigns to divest from the oil and gas sector, and MSPs around this table, we've had letters from constituents saying your pension fund is invested in fossil fuels. We regard that as very bad. It's bad. It's bad for the environment. It's bad for long-term planning. What's your view on this? Is it helpful to have these sort of campaigns running, or what sort of message does it send out for the future of the industry and for people looking to make careers in the industry that these sort of campaigns exist?
So I think the campaigns exist, so we have to respond to them. And I think part of that is making sure we get the facts out onto the table. And part of the anti-fossil fuel campaign is we need to make sure that people understand that actually there is a difference between the fossil fuels, and we shouldn't be, pardon the pun, tarring them all with the same brush. And actually gas is a bridge to the future in terms of a lower carbon economy going forward. So the fact that we have an indigenous resource on our doorstep that offers gas to help us move to a lower carbon economy going forward is a really positive thing, and I think it's really important that those campaigns take that on board and we get those facts out into the room. And then building on your other point about, is this undermining the fact, a future for the industry? I mean, this industry has always been challenged by being a sunset industry. I've been in this industry a very long time, and that's what people said to me when I came into it. And I'm still here, and I'm, working with colleagues who've been around. And we do believe that there is a very strong, sustainable future. And part of what we all need to be doing is encouraging people to understand that there is, and that they are, we will look for skilled jobs and skilled people for many years to come. So it shouldn't be detracting from people having confidence about coming into the industry.
So if we were to take the advice of all these people writing to us and were to divest, what economic impact would that have on the sector, on the Aberdeen economy and on jobs?
So I think it would be, it's not going to be helpful in the debate. If you think about it, the majority of reserves are actually held by the national oil companies rather than the independent oil companies. So that's not going to help. And actually, you want the IOCs, the independent oil companies, are the ones that are prepared to have that debate. So you want to be working with them and not, and getting that, being part of that debate rather than just cutting, stopping off the debate. I think that's a very short term and with unintended consequences.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Jack Brodie's got a supplementary.
Yes, good morning. I hate to disappoint the convener, but having talked to some geological professors that fracking is currently, because of the structure of the UK, geological structure of the UK is not a commercial proposition, I am told. But I'll leave that as it is. Can I just ask on that basis, though, it clearly the international price of oil, one suggests, has been depressed because of, if you like, the Saudi Arabians, for example, trying to offset the price of fracking in the United States. What research have you done in terms of the forward price of oil that comes from fracking, particularly in the United States?
All you can see is over the last years is that shale oil production, unconventional oil production in the States and gas have become more efficient and more cost effective over the last 3 years. So where at some point maybe $70 and above were needed, you're seeing businesses sustained at prices well below $70 now. How that emerges, we will have to see, but that is in many ways a strong feature of the business now.
Richard Lyle got a question at the same point.
Since we are now onto the oil price trends, you may not have been around 30 odd years ago when the Saudi Arabians, you're not that old, the Saudi Arabians basically caused a fall in the oil price then, and the industry has been here before and recovered. And I know the price of oil has gone up and down. It's under $50 at this moment in time. But basically, what trend do you see? Do you agree with some other experts who are saying going up to 75 maybe in the next year or two? What, you know, I know you can't predict the future, but we've been here before. How do we recover?
I alas, I was here 30 years ago, so I claim that one for sure. So there's a technical answer, something called reversion to mean. Over time, prices seem to end at where they have been in the past. And the average over a long period has been in the $60, $65 range. Where things emerge over time, clearly much stronger oil demand now than there was 30 years ago. And so far, supply is actually exceeding demand, which is depressing price. But demand is continuing to increase. So over the long term, there's a much greater likelihood than not that prices will go up. Whether they go up above $100, many other factors you mentioned will determine that.
You know, and you're saying the industry, through you, Convener, the industry, you know, prediction, there was a prediction that way back, you know, in the 60s, this would only last for 50-odd years in the North Sea. You've just said that all these new oil fields coming on. Basically, we can see another 50 years. But, you know, would you agree with me, as we do get, you know, 20, 30, 40 years from now, as the supply decreases, prices will eventually reach, could even reach $200, $300 a barrel?
I think the answer is who knows. I don't think we'd like to predict that. But I think back to Mike's point, when you look ahead, you do see demand increasing. It'll be how do we answer that demand? How do we resource that demand? Do we, in terms of oil and gas, and from obviously renewables and other sources as well? So I think I wouldn't want to predict that.
Thank you.
Lewis McDonald's got a follow-up.
Following on from that and from what Mike Tholen had to say about the reduced break-even price of shale oil and gas from the United States, but looking at the North Sea, the break-even price is clearly critical in the North Sea, as in terms of what price of oil sustains production and what reduced price leads to major loss of production opportunities. Do you have a view on, as an average, on what the break-even price is and on how much you need to reduce cost in order to meet that break-even price for enough of the basin to continue in production?
It is, obviously, as the committee would understand, there is no one-size-fits-all answer,
sure,
because
sure.
If you're a new field in the early years of your production, the break-even price is much lower than we're seeing even today's market. But most fields we've got in the North Sea are in their middle age or even more mature than that. And so clearly are having to manage a much greater balance of cost and relatively low production to run those facilities. So break-even prices, even now there are fields that can cope with the current prices, but they don't have excess cash to reinvest in the opportunities. And so whilst I'm confident that break-even prices are coming down because costs are going down, the real issue is how much cash a company's got to reinvest to do new things, not just sustain their existing businesses.
So there's no simple answer, but as I suspected you would say, but in terms of, if you like, the level, really trying to get from you a sense of what scale of cost reduction gives the North Sea, the mature fields, a future beyond the next couple of years.
Well, I think on a positive note on that one, what we ourselves are seeing is that over this next 2 years, something like 20% of cost is coming out of running the North Sea's facilities. There are new things coming on as well, which can help balance that further. So the industry is doing a massive amount, not always seen quickly, to try and adjust its cost base. And costs globally are coming down as well, which help. So, yes, we are on a period of painful readjustment. Some fields will inevitably be decommissioned because they've reached the end of their productive life and done so quicker because of the very low oil prices. But there is still a future out there for our business.
Okay. Gordon Whittle.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wanted to continue this discussion about the oil price. And, you know, currently we've got an oil price below $50 a barrel, and yet we're seeing oil production increase in comparison to last year. And I just wanted to ask you, the North Sea has been in production for 40 years. And for 30 of those years, the oil price has been below $40 a barrel. And then back in 2000, we heard last week that it was as low as $9 a barrel. So why is the industry in the difficulty it is today, bearing in mind that, you know, for 75% of the time of its existence, the oil price has been below $40 a barrel?
So you've probably got to take two things into account. First of all, alas, inflation. So going back 15, 20 years ago, say 15 years ago in 2000, we were producing nearly three times what we do. Mm-hmm. And yes, the oil price was a lot lower, even then, just before 2000, dropping below $10. But even then, buying power was a lot more, it felt like a lot more money, goodness then, than it does now. So there's the inflation effect, and also we were producing a lot more. So we have fields now producing a lot less, having pretty fixed running costs, so things are a lot tighter because of maturity and because of the age of what we're doing.
Yeah. I wanted to ask about the cost aspect of it as well, because you've said that costs are pretty fixed. Earlier you said that 20% of costs are being removed, and the Energy, Climate and Change Committee at Westminster heard recently that in the North Sea costs have doubled over 5 years. And I was just wondering, you know, what's the reason that you mentioned yourself that there was acceleration in costs in the North Sea? I mean, what is the reason for this acceleration of costs?
Yes, so there's no one item. You know, you can't sort of point to something, otherwise we'd address that. Mm-hmm. It's a mixture of things. So it's we've been operating in a hot market, so your supply demand has got out of kilter. We're also operating in a mature environment, so there is more complexity involved in what we're doing. You've got an older asset infrastructure that requires more effort and is more complex. And also, you know, your big finds of, well, your Brents and your 40s, you're now looking at much smaller accumulations, which are more technologically difficult to get after. So you put all those things together and you have a more costly basin to manage. And so, you know, getting clever about how you do that is part of the issue. And that's why we can't kind of point to one thing and say, that's it. We have to try and address the range and see how we manage each of those areas. Does that make sense?
And given that this fixed cost base, we need to increase productivity from these fields. And again, you know, we've heard evidence to say that the extraction rate in the UK is 40%. And in Norway, it's 60%. So why is there such a big difference in extraction rates between the UK continental shelf and Norway?
When you look at that in more depth, what you see is that both in Norway and in the UK, there's a range of answers depending on the field, the scale and whatever. And certainly, I think others, when they look at it, experts and look at it, do see that there isn't as great a disparity as first appears to be the case, but that companies in the UK continue to try and pursue to recover the greatest they can from the North Sea. So the approach, you'll hear separately from the Oil and Gas Authority, the approach they're driving with the industry, with our trade association, to maximise economic recovery is around the whole philosophy of making the most of what we have in the way of opportunities. So no oil man is wanting to shun what the opportunities are. They're trying to do them in a safe and economic way and maximise that recovery.
And just looking at the downturn in oil production that we had prior to this year, looking back again at the Energy Climate Change Committee at Westminster, it was highlighted that in July 2015, the Oil and Gas UK Industry Safety Report recorded another increase in safety critical backlog, and that prior to August 2014, 36 out of 42 months showed a backlog in all three categories of planned, corrective and deferred maintenance checks. And it was suggested that production was prioritised for those 36 out of 42 months. So is it reality that the oil industry, when the price was high, was deferring any maintenance in order to squeeze as much out of the oil field when price was high? And part of the reason for the downturn in production is that they're now catching up in this maintenance.
So no, I would disagree with that. I think when you're looking at the safety critical maintenance, we have seen an increase in that trend, and it's been something that we have as an industry been concerned about, and we have as an industry been looking at it to try and understand what's been driving it. And companies have also been looking at their own individual performance to challenge it. And again, as the Trade Association, we're undertaking some analysis of it, and we'll be able to report back on that. And we think we have a better understanding of why it has moved in that way. So it's not a trend we like to see. But one thing that I would like to reinforce is that when you have safety critical maintenance and it moves into a backlog, it has had to go through a very robust risk assessment to work out why, you know, if it can be deferred and for how long it should be deferred. So I think people should be reassured that anything that, you know, even in a trend that we don't like to see, the actual maintenance that's gone into that has been risk assessed in an appropriate way.
But we're still looking at 36 out of 42 months where there was a backlog of maintenance checks. I mean,
Surely
that's not acceptable.
No, and that's what we're trying to understand. And there'll be a variety of factors of why that, you know, we're trying to understand why. And some reasons we know is that some companies will put in maintenance that's actually not safety critical. So you know, there'll be reasons why companies have done what they've done. But I think that the point that I really want to reinforce is that when something does go into that backlog, it has gone through a very strong, robust risk assessment that's also obviously regulated by the HSE. So, you know, I don't think there's necessarily a correlation between in terms of safety performance in that regard.
Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And if I may, I'll maybe come back to the health and safety in a minute. I'll maybe try and focus my question towards yourself, Deirdre, if I may. We know that, the first question should be, what current discussions have you had with the UK government with regard to this, the optimism within the oil and gas sector, and primarily towards ensuring that we've got the appropriate skilled workforce for the decommissioning up to 2040, when we're looking at something like 470 installations, 5,000 wells being decommissioned? So I think the initial thing is, what discussions have you had with the UK government? And is it now with the regulator, with Andy Samuels, or are you still engaging with DEC directly and with the Treasury directly?
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. So in relation to the first question, yes, we're working very closely with the regulator. So, and Andy's behind me as I speak. We welcomed the setting up of the regulator as part of the Wood Review, and we see that as a really important means by which we can work, you know, this industry can improve its performance. You need a strong, robust regulator, and we appreciate the fact that the government did set that up, and we look to to make sure that we have a robust and constructive relationship with Andy and his team moving forward. So we do work, we will be working very closely with the OGA, and we will also continue to have discussions with DEC and the other relevant departments that impact our industry. That's very important for us. So the tripartite approach that the Wood Review articulated and pushed for in relation to working with Treasury, working with government and the regulator and industry is something we're very supportive of, and we are continuing to, you know, it's something that we absolutely support because we think it's crucial to making sure that this industry is successful going forward. So that does that answer your first question?
Well, it answers the in terms of your discussions with the obviously UK government. You seem to be suggesting that it's certainly robust discussions. Are you able to influence the direction, or do you believe you'd be able to influence the direction that's been taken with DEC and, say, the Treasury with regard to ensuring the future within the sector?
So absolutely, I think that's a key part of industry's role, is to work closely with DEC and Treasury in terms of the future of the industry. We're currently going through consultations with Treasury on various areas, looking to see where there are opportunities to reduce fiscal barriers. So that's consultation that we're fully involved with at the moment. Mm-hmm. So the answer is yes.
So were you able to influence the Chancellor's direction of travel in November?
In this recent one, yeah. Well, as I said, we're currently going through consultations with Treasury.
So that would be no then?
I mean, the fact is it's a timing issue, and we are working with Treasury to look at these various issues at the minute.
So looking at decommissioning, decommissioning's an opportunity, isn't it, for the sector? It's worth about £41 billion by 2040.
It is. It is an opportunity. What I would like to reinforce, though, is it's not the next industry. What we don't want to see is an acceleration towards decommissioning. Maximising economic recovery, which is, again, what the Wood Review was very focused on and what Andy is, and his team are looking to make sure we drive for, is we have to push out the economic recovery of this basin for as long as we can. We know we have to move into decommissioning at some point, but we need to make sure we decommission when the time is right and we do it in a safe and efficient manner. So it can never replace the industry we have, because it's not going to, you know, support security of supply. It's not going to support the same number of jobs, but it can be a centre of excellence for the UK. And
the global leader, and how do we retain our workforce, our skilled workforce, to ensure that the decommissioning, at when the time is right, of course, is done appropriately and safely?
So how do we do that? Well, we are looking to see how we do go about doing that. Again, we'll be working very closely with the OGA, who have a decommissioning board that's looking to develop a strategy for the next 5 years, but we'll look to answer some of those questions as to how we manage a smooth and effective move into decommissioning that does look to establish the UK as a centre of excellence from which we can then export our expertise around the world. Because if you think about it, we're a maturing basin, but so is every other basin around the world. We're just slightly ahead of them. So there are means being set up by which we can do that.
It's an opportunity we can't afford to miss.
It's an opportunity we have to manage very well, and we have to manage effectively, and to make sure that we do it in a very cost-effective and safe manner.
Okay.
James is quite keen to come in and respond to this.
I mean, we're on record as saying before that, you know, the fact that we're a frontier basin actually gives a perverse benefit in that we get to try some things before others. And I think it's actually quite exciting from our point of view to see the OG established and the work that they're starting to do now. They won't do the decommissioning, but of course they've got the opportunity to work with industry to set out a strategy. And I think one of the opportunities is, you know, with that type of kind of strategic approach, is that when you see a kind of baseline load of work, you can actually plan that in a slightly different way with decommissioning, and that actually allows the supply chain to engage. Supply chain will step up to the plate. I'm absolutely sure the OGA won't directly engage with them, I suspect,
But by setting out the strategy, there's a real opportunity there. So I think with decommissioning, we can do something slightly different.
It's optimistic. Mike, on a few occasions, suggested mature and older, and I was starting to get a degree of empathy coming across the table. But I'm just wondering, with regard to the ageing infrastructure, we heard from the unions that there's perhaps a safety issue that's not being addressed, and there would appear from what they're saying, and this is their terms, or sort of a culture of fear growing, that they're at a stage that they're reluctant to report incidents of perhaps safety issues. Now, that would be extremely serious, I think. And I'm just wondering, what are you doing to try and redress their fears? And I know you have been working with unions, but they are indicating quite seriously that there is this culture that if they do report something, they could lose their job. Surely that's not the case.
So we're certainly aware of the union's concern, because as you said, we've met with them and discussed these issues. And what we want to make sure we do encourage is that people are confident that they can, you know, they can report issues where they see them. They have their own mechanisms within their own companies, and they also have the HSE whistleblowing line, which is an anonymous one where they can report where they see concerns. I mean, I think, you know, again, a reinforcement, safe production is absolutely what this industry has to be about. And if you're hearing from your constituents, you know, that this is of a concern, you know, we need to be urging them to actually pick up the phone and raise these issues. You know, let me know about them so that we can work together to address where there are concerns, because it is if it is an issue, then we need to be addressing it.
You read the report from last week, or were aware of the report from the trade unions that we had in last week, and the concerns were raised there. If you haven't seen that report, I'm quite sure that we would be able to provide that. So can I just stay with the health and safety just for a second? It's anonymised, you're saying. Again, the trade unions are suggesting that although it's anonymised, because of the nature of reporting, that they still feel that it could come back to particular individuals. How do we address their fears that, you know, that safety is absolute paramount? Yeah, your job should be safe, but, you know, safety is paramount above everything else.
So I think it's something we have to reinforce. And obviously, if there are concerns about the HSE whistleblowing line, which is, you know, kind of the last defence, then we need to address that. And I think that's something that we need to look at going forward, so that people can feel confident that they can use it, and that their concerns will be listened to.
So that's something you can actually take on?
I will take that on, yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Kabir.
Thank you. Okay, I've got a number of members who want to ask supplementary things on decommissioning. Can we please all be brief, because we're getting behind the clock, so start with John McCall.
Thanks very much. Yes, Deirdre, I got from you a kind of hint of caution with regard of rushing too fast into the decommissioning road, and I was struck by Mr. Vaz's comment, the Bond Dickinson comment in the Chamber of Commerce report, where he says something similar, I think. He basically says that, you know, it means that the industry will be eating away at its own bones, but it will go down decommissioning route if that's where the incentives are. Now, obviously, there's a tax incentive to decommission, but, you know, the Scottish Government, for example, has been calling for an exploration tax credit. So I assume that, you know, if the industry is faced with the incentives to decommission, but not to do further exploration, it's going to go down the decommissioning route. Would you say that's correct?
So I think that we're looking at, in terms of fiscal barriers, we are looking at each of those areas: exploration, decommissioning and infrastructure. And you're right, we need to make sure we get that balance right. Yeah. But Mike, do you want to say a bit about those areas in terms of the exploration and the decommissioning?
So as Julie mentioned, first of all, in the decommissioning space, there's no specific incentive to decommission. In the first place, if you decommission, it costs the company concerned an awful lot of money, some of which is relievable through their tax regime. So would they rather decommission? They'd actually rather keep the business running if they could, because that's still making money for that concern and allowing a taxable income. So, you know, the balance is still around trying to run assets safe and well for as long as they can do, rather than decommission. But if assets do go through decommissioning, technology has moved on, so if there are new discoveries, it's not that loss of any infrastructure is a loss of all of the opportunities. We can reach further back from longer distance now through subsea tiebacks and a whole range of technologies still to recover more from less infrastructure, albeit, no, we don't want to see that go needlessly.
I take it you'd be keen to, in order to see more exploration, to see an exploration tax credit then?
I'm keen that we work the process that we are working through with government, with the OGA, with the Treasury, to make sure that the tax regime is not a barrier to activity in exploration.
Do you think it is just now?
I think that the biggest problems at the minute are a shortage of cash to invest in exploration in the UK, so we need to be competitive in the first place. Find the opportunities, which a lot of good work has been doing, not least the state-sponsored seismic that's going on now. The OGA is working hard to help us look at the licensing regime to be smart on licensing. So mostly the barriers are not around tax. Yes, tax may help, but it is not the simple answer to a very complex problem.
Okay. Right, we need to move on. John Lovett.
Thank you very much. I want to go back to the issue, particularly about the evidence that was given last week by the trade unions. And if you haven't read it in detail, I would... when you get the opportunity, I suggest that you do, because what comes across very strongly is people who are committed to the industry but very, very concerned about what's actually happening in terms of decisions that have been made. I mean, I think the charge that's been laid, and I'm interested in your comments on this. You talked earlier, Deirdre, about reducing cost and increased efficiency. And I think what was coming across last week was that that reduction in cost, increased efficiency, was the expense in terms of conditions of the workforce and health and safety.
So, again, I understand and I'm aware of the union's concern in this this regard, and I think what I would reinforce is that actually the pain and the impact is being felt across the industry. There's no one area or one set of workforce that's feeling this particularly more than anybody else. So, you know, it's an impact that's being felt across the piece, and companies are having to make difficult decisions, because you know, when you've any industry that's seen a 60% reduction in its revenue has to do something fundamental to address that, and so difficult decisions that are impacting at a very personal level are having to be taken. So what are we doing that's a bit different in this space? I think the work of the Scottish Enterprise Task Force has been very welcome and has been different in terms of addressing this downturn. You know, they've set up three PACE events in Aberdeen, which have been attended by over 850 people at each one. And that's been about working with the people who've been made redundant or who are under threat of redundancy, and looking to support them as they go through these difficult times. So so it is tough. It is challenging, but I really believe that as an industry, we are very focused on ensuring we maintain safe production, and that's the mantra that's going to take us through this, and that we're doing everything we can to support our workforce, recognising that people will have done and will continue to lose their jobs.
Can you explain then why production costs are lower in Norway while worker terms and conditions are seemingly better? That's the evidence we were given last week.
So Norway benefits in one sense by being a younger oil province than the UK. So production costs of activity costs are, if anything, often reported to be slightly more expensive in Norway. But the cost, because you're producing much more per field than many bigger fields still in Norway, the cost per barrel typically are lower. And so that's where they feel advantaged compared with the UK. They are less mature in the business, and so that cost per barrel thing is better.
Okay. I wondered also, you talked about the health and safety issues. Mm-hmm. We were told last week that the helpline wasn't worthwhile. The unions have become a conduit for the workers' concerns, which I think is legitimate if they're generally concerned about their jobs. So what contact do you have directly with the trade unions on a regular basis to hear these concerns?
So we met with them a couple of weeks ago, and part of that conversation was, okay, so if you're seeing issues that are coming up, you know, we can work with you on those. If you can share with us where you're seeing the issues, and then that'll enable us to see what we can do in that space. So we have met with the unions on an ongoing basis, perhaps not as regularly as we should, but there is a commitment to make sure that we have regular engagements going forward.
You will now meet regularly with them, and one agenda item would be, what are these health and safety concerns?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because behind that is also concerns around informal or formal blacklisting, and we know historically that's happened, which kind of explains why people may be concerned. So would you take the opportunity at those regular meetings to explore their concerns around the question of blacklisting?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, whatever's on the agenda, we're happy to discuss. I mean, there's nothing that shouldn't be on that agenda.
And do you think that the Energy Skills Task Force, I mean, you talked about PACE, which is really how do you deal with the fact people are losing their jobs?
Yes.
Should that task force also be addressing the concerns about how you actually, there are ways of maintaining jobs and sustaining jobs rather than simply being, it has to be about redundancies?
That's an interesting question. I think certainly the task force has been focused on helping to mitigate the actual impact. I mean, the task force is still ongoing, and part of its remit, though, is to look to see where people can move into other sectors and what are the opportunities.
I suppose the point I'm making is if there's a presumption that there's no alternative to redundancy, you don't have that conversation, but actually are there things, decisions that are being made that mean that jobs are being lost unnecessarily? Is that space for that? I'll give you an example. Again, last week we were given evidence that moving to 3 weeks on, 3 weeks off shift rota actually creates further problems. And I wonder how was that tested, or have you seen people testing that? I suppose they're just saying, well, by definition, it means there are fewer helicopter journeys, so it must be make sense. There may be other consequences to that kind of rota, which actually reduces productivity. And again, is that task force a place where that discussion could take place?
So, OK, let me take that. Thank you for that. Let me take the rota point. We have seen many companies move to a three-on-three-off rota, and that's because they see that there's an opportunity, not just in terms of cost and efficiency, but also we actually believe there's a safety improvement because you're taking out back-to-backs. There's a safety opportunity there. Three-on-three rotas have been successfully used in the industry for years, with no negative consequences. So, you know, from a safety point of view, a three-on-three move is actually a very positive, it can be seen as a very positive.
Why do you think the trade unions don't think that? They actually talked about the impact on the health and well-being of people who were working and their concerns about the impact, therefore, on productivity.
So I think in terms of the concerns that the unions have, again, when you move, you go through a management of change when you move to a three-on-three, and that's robustly assessed, again, you know, within HSE guidelines. So no company will move to make a deliberate move to make their workforce unproductive. You know, they see benefits in doing this, not only in terms of for the business, but also in terms of the workforce. It's not an unsafe thing to do by any means, and we've proven that over the years.
So you've got the evidence for that?
Yes.
So the unions, when they're saying they're concerned about the impact on the mental health and fatigue of the members, that is not that doesn't stack up with research that you have.
So certainly in terms of the experience we've had as an industry, but you know, it's their concerns are legitimate, and it's something that we should make sure we continue to work with them on. But as I said, we have robust assessment processes to ensure that you know, if you have somebody that's fatigued, that's something you would take into account in terms of how you're managing your offshore workforce.
I just wonder whether you thought that in some cases there was a short-termism around changing rotas. That it was something to move to in circumstances where you need to make savings, and in fact it might be counterproductive. Would your advice be to companies to get the evidence first before the shift? Because certainly last week the suggestion was it just looked like a way of doing something quickly because there's a problem.
So I would reinforce the fact, you know, the drilling community have been successfully doing three weeks on, 3 weeks off for years, and have done it, you know, very successfully, and have been very productive as a result.
You need to explain then why, in the past, they didn't shift to these rotas. If they were very productive and sensible, presumably they've done it at a time when there wasn't a crisis.
So I think, again, not all companies. So each company have looked to see what their optimum operation is. I think it's about 7 or 8 companies have moved to this particular rota. Others have chosen not to. And they've done it on the basis of what works best for them in terms of their particular business. So it's not a blanket approach at all. It's a thoughtful approach that they're applying because they see an opportunity to improve their performance and their production and their productivity.
I mean, I think there would be people who would be sceptical about that in terms of it would then have been something that had been rolled out over a long period of time rather than at a point where there are real challenges. And my last question, I'm interested in your views. One of the bits of evidence that came up last week was on the use of non-European maritime workers and the particular concerns of RMT for British seafarers that they were not going to be operating any longer in the North Sea, and their concerns that there was a consequent impact on the safety, on jobs, obviously, but also the safety of the workforce who are then doing these jobs. I wonder if you have a view on the use of, I think it was described as a loophole in the legislation, which meant that we were putting at risk jobs for British maritime workers, but also for the terms and conditions of those workers who are coming in.
Yeah, so again, I'm aware of that concern. It's not something that we have the remit for in our trade association, but it's something that we can certainly raise with other trade associations who are directly responsible for that particular area.
Should you have a view given the impact on the industry of being served by a maritime workforce with poor terms and conditions and potentially issues around safety?
I think from an industry point of view, you know, it's important to us that our people are rewarded appropriately and fairly across the board.
So is this something you will pursue then?
It's something, as the trade association for what we're responsible for, it's not something I'm, you know, have a direct influence over, but I'm certainly happy to raise it with the trade associations that are.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just follow up one point that came out of the trade union evidence last week that I don't think Joanne Lamont's raised, and that's the issue of common standards, which was raised by the trade union reps who told us that if common standards could be enforced across the industry so that contractors moving from platform to platform, from company to company, were not having to relearn and adjust their practices, that would drive up productivity considerably and drive down costs. Is that something you have a view on?
I think, and we've got our step change in safety body that's looking to do exactly that, especially around safety opportunities. So it's something that, yeah, as an industry, we recognise that there are opportunities there and we should be pursuing them.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm conscious of time. I've got so 2 members who want to come in, and then if there's time, we might get some supplementaries, but I'll start with Chick Brody first.
Thank you. Good morning again. And thank you for an impressive contribution this morning. I'd like to address the issue that I think Dennis Robertson raised, which is how do we retain our workforce? And I do so on the predication that the IMF said there will be a partial recovery of price to $75 a barrel. Brent crude are talking about upwards of $70 in 2017, and the Economic Recovery Agency are talking about more than $80. My first question is a somewhat parochial one, on the basis that we've talked about the Clare Ridge, and after some long investigation, have determined that we're now probing the availability of oil and gas in the Clyde and the Atlantic margins. What do we have to do to encourage the oil companies to pursue with the academics who are now doing it, to pursue the possibility of what would be cheaper oil because it would be a lot nearer land?
Both through the OGA and previously through DEC, there continues to be the licensing around the UK of opportunities. I know of no company that's explicitly pursuing opportunities in and around the Clyde. I know of some that have looked in the past. Were they still pursuing those opportunities? Maybe there'd be a different conversation. I'm not privy to the outcome of those.
There was a licence issued in 1984, PL262, to BP, and the drilling and the then Secretary of State for Scotland said there was oil in exploitable quantities. George Younger and his compatriot in the Thatcher government, Michael Heseltine, stopped it because of nuclear submarine passage up and down the Clyde. villages were built, Ardrossan Harbour was bought. You know, I just wonder, as a personal frustration, what do we need to do to look at not just the Aberdeen issue, which is, of course, very important, but looking at oil around the rest of our shores?
Alas, that predates even my entry into the industry. So I'm sure that the OJ and others are looking at licensing those opportunities where they think people will pursue those opportunities.
Okay, thank you. The second thing,
let me build on that. It's just as Mike mentioned earlier, the OGA has been, and Treasury gave 20 million in terms of seismic, and I'm sure Andy will talk about this, and that is looking at frontiers that we haven't addressed. So one in the Rockall area, so not quite where you'd like it.
Well, and there's some off Tyree, but I mean,
yeah, well, okay, so maybe
being very parochial, I'm interested in the Clyde.
but basically, there, you know, so we've talked earlier about how this is a mature basin, and yes, it is. But I think also the other point to make is there's still frontier opportunities in this area. And so as part of the work that the OGA will be looking to do, as Mike said, is in terms of licensing and the opportunities that the information around the Rockall areas and the to the central belt will central sorry not the belt but the central part of the North Sea will be available in spring 2016, and so that might bring more opportunities.
Yeah, it's just that, you know, the company Providence, and they might say this, mightn't they, that they have, based on their exploration, reckon there's 500 million barrels of oil off Rathlin Island, which is just south of the Mullock and Tyre. I'll keep propagating. The second question, perhaps to James, is you know, some people get, you know, concerned, rightly, in terms of the environmental impact of burning oil. But of course, it's much more important than that, in that it pervades all aspects of our life. What I don't understand is why we never use the vertical integration capability of oil and using oil-based or, you know, getting companies to use oil-based products to manufacture in Scotland. Why did that happen, and is it too late to make it happen?
Well, I'm not sure I can answer that with any great evidence, I'm afraid. So the way that the oil and gas industry works is we have our operators and our supply chain, and the product then, you know, goes on to be used for all sorts of things. You know, when you look at the oil and gas sector, I guess a lot of people think about the oil, but actually the gas, you know, is in itself extremely important, and you know, used for a variety of products. I'm not sure. Actually, the vertical integration is necessarily important. I guess from my point of view, you know, if I were to go to a business, they'd probably say it's not something we're interested in, or indeed it is, and they'd base that on sheer, you know, business economics.
Forgive me, we have an energy jobs task force.
Yeah.
I just wonder if downstream products that are oil-based or utilising gas, is that part of the conversation going forward in terms of how, I mean, if we're laying off people in Aberdeen, are there other activities that we can encourage in terms of inward investment to that area that uses that raw material? I know it's got to go through the refinery and what have you, but yeah.
Yeah, possibly. I'm not on the Energy Jobs Task Force, so I can't really say whether it's in the remit. I suspect probably not. I think, you know, companies themselves are generally the ones who look around how they diversify. I'm not sure necessarily the kind of public sector in its widest sense intervening there would necessarily be of help. That said, you know, the support of SDI, UKTI generally is really important for, you know, continued success in international markets. In terms of FDI, I'm not sure I see an immediate opportunity, but, you know, it's possible I'm missing something there.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Richard Lyle.
I have to get it on the record. Is the UK still self-sufficient in oil supply?
Alas, no longer. It's been a number of years, probably a decade or more, since we started to go below being self-sufficient, and we're producing roughly half our oil and roughly half our gas demand in the UK.
So basically, it's costing, you know, if we look at the balance of payments, it's costing us a lot of money to import oil from other countries.
as we are a net importer of oil and gas, but we still otherwise displace an awful lot of oil and gas we otherwise would need to import, half a billion barrels of oil and gas a year at least extra if we didn't produce what we do now.
Yeah. Can I turn to your press release that Deirdre Michie put out? You're basically saying government figures show that continued demand for our product, oil and gas, will continue to provide 70% of our energy to 2030 and beyond. Billions of barrels of oil, and Chick Brody went on about the factor of, you know, there's still opportunities in the whole, you know, the surrounding areas of Scotland for extraction. A supply chain worth $39 billion. We have the capability to maintain a significant contribution to Scotland and the UK. But the future over the next 50 years is in the hands of industry, governments and regulators. What would you do as an industry to, and going to a point that John McAlpine went on about earlier, you know, in regards to what the UK government is incentivising you to do or to help you, what would you like to see? If you had a wish list tomorrow, now's your opportunity to tell us, what would you like governments to do, regulators to do, and the industry to do to bring back the employment that we deserve?
That's a very good question. I just point out we are at the end of our time, so if we can have a fairly short response, that would be very helpful.
Okay, so thank you. What is our ask? Our ask is that you keep us on your agenda, whichever, you know, both governments, that you continue to understand the importance of this industry at Westminster and at Holyrood, and you keep us high on your list, and you continue to understand the challenges, and you continue to support us. That is the request of you as our Scottish government and of the Westminster government.
Thank you.
I'd just add that you know, we've asked companies what it requires to maintain their interest in the UK in the sector. They're very clear that it's labour, the retention of the cluster in the UK, and connectivity to international markets. These come out as the top three things. In that respect, one thing that I would ask is that, you know, so far as you feel able and that you back the city deal negotiation, I think it's really the one show in town which enables the cluster to survive.
Lewis, we're all desperate to get in with a question, so I'll quick question.
Just to give Deirdre Wakey the opportunity to say if that's also the view of Oil and Gas UK, that the city deal is critical to
going forward. Thank you, Lewis. No, absolutely, absolutely. We're very supportive of the city and shire deal. It's really important. It's really important that to Aberdeen, obviously, but as Aberdeen is so crucial to the oil and gas industry for the UK, the success of Aberdeen is critical to the success of the industry generally. So thank you, Lewis. We are absolutely behind it and want to see it successful.
And Aberdeen Shire.
Great. Okay.
I said Shire.
And the Shire, yes. Shire. On that note, we have to call matters to a close. Can I thank you all very much for coming? It's been extremely helpful to the committee. We'll now have a very short suspension to allow a changeover. That was very good. reconvene. Thank you. Can I welcome our second panel this morning? I'm delighted that we are joined by Sir Patrick Brown, who is Chair of the Oil and Gas Authority, and Andy Samuel, Chief Executive. Welcome to you both. I think before we get into questions, I think, Sir Patrick, you want to say something by way of an introductory statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I thought I'd better start by trying to give you a sort of scene setting for this new regulator, which has now been running for 6 months. It took on, as you know, the former licensing responsibilities of DEC, but also this new remit that came out of the Wood review. I have invented regulators, and I have also served on companies that have been regulated. So when I took this job, I made it clear that I wanted it to be a regulator like no other, in a sense, because it was not going to be autocratic, it was not going to be bureaucratic, it was going to be limited in its size, because regulators can just grow and grow, and that very seriously throughout the organisation, we would be seeing our role as a member of a team, of a partnership, call it what you will, with industry, with the unions, with the governments, and with Oil and Gas UK, all the players, because we are clearly aware that unless we, perhaps as the body in the middle, unless we can persuade people to do things sensibly together, then MER UK will not work. And I thought I'd put that down. We are new. We've covered a lot of ground, and Andy will no doubt tell you, and I think he's done an amazing job in getting us to where we are now. But obviously, as government changes, the regulator is formed, is pulled out of government, new responsibilities arise, there are sometimes some difficult questions about who does what, and that we are sorting out with DEC. But I just thought I'd set the scene and say thank you for inviting us, and we look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. So we've got about an hour for questions this morning. I'll let you decide between yourselves who will field the questions, perhaps. And I would ask members to keep their questions as ever short and to the point, and answers as short and to the point as possible would be helpful. Can I maybe just start by picking up on your last point, Sir Patrick, about the relationship with the Department of Energy and Climate Change? What if you say a little bit more about how that's going to work? And in particular, are you going to do what they say, or are they going to do what you say? Or how's that going to operate?
It's not quite like that. We are going to have some very clear roles as regulator. And we are going to be independent in the execution of those roles. And I'm absolutely clear on that. We are not going to be in the position where ministers can ring up and say, do this. Absolutely not. If ministers or their officials ring up and say, could you help us with something, we will look at it and say, is this part of our remit? And if it is, then of course we'll be helpful. But what we will not do is get ourselves involved in any sense of the policy of the government of the day, because I think that would be just completely wrong.
But conversely, will you make recommendations to the government and to DEC about areas where you think
certainly
things should change?
We as a body, like anybody else in the country, can make recommendations to government about things that need to change. And perhaps if there are things which aren't working in the UKCS that we think should change and are DEC's responsibility, of course we'd be bound to say to them.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Okay, I'm going to move on to look at some of the health and safety issues. I'll start off with Dennis Robertson.
Thank you very much, and good morning, gentlemen. You're probably aware that the trade union are concerned at the moment within the industry that health and safety is being compromised due to cost efficiency. Do you have a role to try and ensure that the industry is maintaining health and safety to the highest standards? I think that's probably what we need to sort of get on record, that health and safety is paramount. But
the unions are concerned that it's being compromised due to cost efficiencies. Do you have a view on that?
So, I am. You'll be aware of the Scottish Energy Jobs Task Force.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I worked, led along with a couple from industry, was an engagement on May the 22nd, where we got what I call the whole system together. And I insisted that we had offshore workers, safety reps, and the unions in the room. And it worked very well, because I think their voice is vital to the debate. I think the unions themselves, and I now meet with them regularly, would be the first to say, and I think they said it last week, that the industry leaders obviously walk the talk on safety, but are there some unintended consequences, particularly during downturns like we're experiencing right now? I had a very good meeting with six of the union chiefs 3 weeks ago, and I said, how can I help? How can the regulator help in this? I explained that we have very close relations, as you would expect, with the Health and Safety Executive, who in terms of regulatory capacity take the lead here. However, it's vital that we also do our bit. I explained also that we have a memorandum of understanding that Richard Judge, the chief exec of the HSE, and I agreed, and we have regular meetings with them to make sure that we're very joined up, and particularly to make sure that we're not doing anything, for example, in our primary aim of maximising economic recovery that could go against safety, and I'm very confident we're not. What the unions asked me to do was to hold industry to account on their commitments, and I'm very happy to do that. That's something a regulator should do. We have a role around stewardship, for example, and part of that we'll look at their how are they managing their operations and are they efficient. The unions also asked me to spread positive stories, of which there are many. There are some operators doing some outstanding work. And then the third thing we talked about, and it relates to the second, is, and it's something I'm passionate about having managed operations myself, is you get the safest and most efficient operations when you engage with your workforce. In fact, now more than ever is the time when operators should be going offshore, listening to the workers offshore, because that's actually where the smart ideas come from. And obviously, and when, you know, frankly, this thing about safety concerns, sit down in the tea shack, spend a couple of nights offshore, and it's pretty hard not to find out what's going on. My experience is that offshore workers are very open when you actually take time in their workplace. The engagement with the workforce is something we're passionate about. Nexon have done that brilliantly, I would argue, over the last two quarters, and they demonstrated continued safe operations and a remarkable, I think, 40% increase in offshore productivity. So wrench time, which is the time, productive time spent per shift, has gone from 5.5 hours to 8 hours. This is something that other companies have been talking about for years. Nexon have shown how you do it through brilliant offshore engagement. And of course, the unions fully support that approach. So I think there are some strong clues as to what works well. We also know what doesn't work well, which is rapid changes without workforce engagement. So we absolutely support, and I think it's good for business, it's definitely good for safety, really good engagement.
So would you commend, Mr. Samuels, would you commend the sort of standardisation then of an approach like, for instance, Nexon? I mean, I saw the Nexon presentation. It was an excellent presentation in how they did engage, and certainly would commend it to the rest of the industry, because they started off with health and safety. It wasn't production. It wasn't cost efficiency. It was health and safety. That's basically their starting point. Is that something you would commend to the rest of the industry? And how can you influence them then to have this sort of standardisation, this a collaborative approach to health and safety?
So there are two things there. So first of all, on commending just really good safe operations, I was delighted that, actually it was a brilliant session I think we had in this room, myself and with Nexon, and shortly after that we published it actually to make sure that it was widely picked up. I was very pleased when quite a number of companies approached Nexon direct. Some came through us and said, can we sit down with Nexon and understand what they've done? So I think just sharing positive, good practices can be extremely powerful, and we will continue to do that. On standardization, it's a curious thing. You know, the industry have been talking about this for decades. I was at the Oslo Energy Forum 2 years ago in Norway, and it was a huge conversation as people were beginning to see that costs across the North Sea, both sides of the median line, were in a very unhealthy position. And I've met with chief execs, not just local MDs, more recently and asked, well, you were talking about this 2 years ago, what are you doing? And it's still quite hard. And it comes down to leadership. I'm hoping now, you know, if there's one benefit of this downturn, it will be a transformation of some practices, including standardization. And by the way, that doesn't limit innovation. Actually, you know, standardizing some things will create space to be more innovative in other areas. We are seeing some really good examples. Subsea 7 shared with me some very good work that they've shared publicly at Offshore Europe, where they've now got a standard solution for subsea tiebacks, for normally pressured, normally temperature tiebacks. By the way, we've got 200 discoveries out there already. And if we can drive down the cost through transforming how these are developed, there's a massive opportunity. A further 20 billion of investment could come from that. That's something we're pushing very hard through the Technology Leadership Board, which we now co-chair. And I was very pleased when Subsea 7 came along and said, we've got a solution that can yield a 40% cost reduction. And this, the important word here is cost. This isn't price cutting. This is a different way of working that creates a much more efficient and more value-adding solution. So those are the kind of things we're really promoting wherever possible.
Yeah, I mean, I'm delighted to hear the optimism and certainly the work and the opportunities for the subsea sector are probably not particularly recognised at the moment, and that's maybe a message we need to get out of there. But as a regulator, what can you do to ensure that health and safety remains paramount within the industry? And if it's not, if industry isn't compliant or you feel that not being compliant, can you do anything as a regulator?
We are not the health and safety regulator.
I appreciate that, but so I'm just wondering if you've got anything in terms of you license the industry.
We do, yes. We don't have any formal sanctions around safety. Clearly,
but you can within the license, can you not? Can you influence in terms of saying, look, if you don't comply with or you feel that there's issues, do you have?
I think that's rather stepping on the patch of the health and safety executive. Yeah. I mean, they have the powers, they have the investigatory powers, they have the enforcement abilities, and I don't think we should get in the way of them carrying out their job. If we see things that they haven't, of course we'll let them know. But I think it must be up to them to take the enforcement steps.
John Lamont.
Going back to this question of health and safety, would you accept in a time when, I mean, I'm encouraged by what you said about the relationship with the trade unions, but a time when people are fearful for their jobs, they're less likely to be frank when you're at an open meeting, and the unions are saying that people feel that they're unwilling to go to the health and safety executive. So what mechanisms can you put in place where those concerns are relayed to you and perhaps through you to the health and safety executive if that has been identified as a problem currently?
I've managed safe operations across various parts of the world for the last decade. And one thing that's clear to me is change is unsettling. And, you know, the industry has been talking about human factors for the last decade. And I think it's increasingly recognised that, you know, where people's minds are has a large part to play on whether an operation is safe or not. So absolutely am I aware, as are all industry leaders, that during an unsettling period, one needs to pay even more attention. We have our own OGA workforce that go offshore as part of our metering duties. I've asked them themselves to keep more of an ear out for any worrying trends. They haven't reported specifically. Clearly, there is when people are concerned about their future jobs, that is not a good thing. So the sooner industry can get through this period of change, the better. But beyond that, in terms of the effectiveness of or not of the current reporting regime, I do think, as you know, you heard Deirdre will pick that up, but also the health and safety executive should be very concerned if that's actually not working, because that is a vital safeguard. I will certainly mention that to them next time I meet with them as well.
That's very helpful. Would you expect minimum standards around engagement with workforce?
I think minimum basic standards are always very good, yes.
And you would identify them in conversation with any operators then? That's what your expectation would be?
That's not part of our regulatory duty. It comes back to, though, there's as one of the members has already alluded to, there's a very strong relationship between well-run, efficient operations and safe operations. Mm-hmm. So some of the things that we're looking for in our standard stewardship around efficient operations, I have no doubt that the health and safety executive are looking at similar things, and that's why we agreed we should be joined up in our approach going forward.
I mean, I think there would be a concern if you're saying, well, it's not really our patch to deal with health and safety. If health and safety hasn't got the resources or people aren't contacting them, there must be something, surely, where you report something to the health and safety executive that they would report back to you they had done something about it. My fear is that we're going to end up, these concerns are disappearing, but they actually have a huge impact on the workforce and, of course, on
if specific concerns are relayed to us, we will, of course, not just report those, but then make sure it's followed up. I think that is a basic with safety. You don't just kind of see it, you have to own it. Mm-hmm. And my team will follow up in with that.
Okay, thank you.
Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Pardon the word I'm going to use, but this situation is man-made. At the end of the day, you go into any trading floor in the stock exchange and they're to dictate the price of oil. We've just learned earlier from a question I asked that we're not sufficient in oil now. It's costing us billions. And if you go into the balance of payments, Britain is now billions of pounds in the red in balance of payments. At the end of the day, gentlemen, I would hold you to account to encourage the industry to invest. We've got all these extra fuels that are lying out there that could be used. We have a situation where we're told earlier that because some fields are 30, 40 years old, it's a cost. But also it was said that any new field, like say Norway, is a lower cost. So what do you intend to do to improve this man-made situation of a downturn in the oil industry in Aberdeen particularly, but in the UK, if you want to take the UK as a whole?
An awful lot is the answer, and there's a risk we may take on too much, and we can talk about that. So we've just published our corporate plan for consultation. My chair gave me a very good challenge. What will success look like in 5 years? Can you really, really kind of test your team that we're leaving no stone unturned? Within one caveat, we agreed early on that we will not have a headcount that will exceed a curious number of 179. It's a number I came up with in an early draft of a business plan. But the serious point there is that the mission is quite large, and it also overlaps with other government departments, both UK and Scottish. And we need to make sure we keep our focus on our primary mission, which is maximising economic recovery. So what are we doing? We've got a sector strategy, a draft already being formulated for exploration, stewardship, infrastructure. We're doing a lot of work with Treasury, as you heard earlier. I can say a bit more about that on the fiscal side. We're also working with investors to help them see what it, every time I meet with them, they are, I think I would summarize it as impressed with the pace of change and what both governments have been doing to support this industry compared to what they're seeing in other places where they operate around the world. That is not to say there isn't a lot more to do. There is. But I think our job is to, you know, we talk about driving investment, creating the right conditions where companies want to invest. In parallel with our corporate plan consultation, led by DEC, but obviously with very strong input from ourselves, has been the MER UK strategy consultation that was launched a couple of weeks ago. And this is a very important document, actually. And we've had very good feedback from industry and the workshops in Aberdeen and London. That defines, if you like, the meat on the bone of what really is our primary mission and how we intend to do it and the obligations it places on industry. I think it's important to point out in that, though, it does not give us as a regulator the power to force companies to invest. but it does create a use it or lose it mentality. Now, it's no good asking a company to lose a valuable license if no one else wants to come in and take it on. So we need to make this basin attractive going forward. So the kind of work we're doing, and we've made a start, like using very, you know, to massive value, actually, the 20 million we got from Treasury, to go and get some new data, some new seismic in highly prospective areas, we hope. We're not going to then just publish the data on its own. We're getting it processed at the moment. We're going to try and add value to that by highlighting the prospectivity. So we're recruiting as best we can good geologists, geophysicists and other people to really highlight the prospectivity. We'll through that, we'll take a good look at areas like the Clyde as well. You know, anywhere that we think there is a...
I'm
that,
on your side.
That's the point I was going to ask you next. You know, at the end of the day, if you go back to the 70s, there was all the licensing and the whoosh, suddenly all the infrastructure and the work that suddenly came in all the different places. So there are many other, like Chick Brody said earlier, there are many other places within the radius of Scotland's shores that have undiscovered oil. So we know that oil companies want to maximise profit and maybe are doing a downturn, but you now are encouraging them and also you're going to be putting out licenses, just to let me know and the committee know, that you're putting out licenses in other places that, where there's no exploration at this moment in time?
So all future licenses are always subject to the environmental assessment, which is, again, it's a different regulator. This time it's the environmental regulator within DEC. So we always have to caveat, and that's potentially one of the issues with the Clyde. I mean, just on the Clyde, actually, we're looking at it because it's an analogue for the Rockall, which is the area where we've just shot a vast amount of new 2D data. So we're extrapolating the geology. The Clyde, we think the basins are actually a bit small, and whilst there are a few shows, the current view is it's probably not hugely prospective, but it doesn't mean, you know, with new thinking, perhaps new data, new ideas, never say never. But there are a whole bunch of basins around our shores that need to be looked at. And this was one of the reasons that Surian made the recommendation. The previous department did not have sufficient people, sufficient funds to leverage data, and sufficient just overall resources to do a job to really highlight the prospectivity. We can't change Mother Nature, but what we can do is make sure we give ourselves the best chance of maximising recovery from whatever we've got. I think data is worth just pausing on. There is a huge opportunity. We need to make sure that the wealth of data that's been acquired over 40, 50 years is much more leveraged by the regulator, but also by industry. You know, so there are many, you know, we've talked to, there are promote companies, for example, small outfits, but with excellent geoscientists. Give them access to data, they can turn that into really good new concepts that can then excite companies to come in and invest. So certainly on exploration, we're almost finding there's too many good ideas, and the chair and I are trying to impose a discipline where we try and encourage not just us but industry, because we're working this collaboratively through the new boards we set up. What are the top three opportunities for next year? Let's please focus, let's get them over the line. The boards and the MER UK forum that we've set up will be publicly held to account, because we will issue minutes and an annual report. So there'll be a lot more visibility going forward on priorities, progress, and I think this will further encourage investors, because they can see that things are going. When I speak to investors, though, that the headline is the concerns they used to have about fiscal instability are receding. The Treasury's driving investment plan helps them an awful lot. That's not to say that there isn't still work to do on fiscal, and we can talk about that. They're encouraged by the new regulator, but they want us to keep focus. They are a bit worried that about mission creep. And actually, they are encouraged that, you know, it's interesting, this year will probably be the first year that we have a better exploration success rate than Norway. Apache have made three very noticeable discoveries and have very generously shared some of that information, which is good for them and their shareholders, but it's actually very good for the basin. There's nothing like a bit of success to breed an appetite to invest more. I mean, just those discoveries, by the way, two of them were in very, very mature areas around Beryl and Forties, and it just shows. And I, in fact, I met the their exploration geophysicist recently, and he's rightly proud of the work he's done. And it's leveraging the latest high-quality 3D seismic. So we ran a workshop the day before Offshore Europe, where we got 20 of the largest companies together and highlighted the benefit of new 3D data for unlocking prospectivity. And that was very well received, because actually technology moves on very quickly in this area, and we need to make sure companies keep up to date with that opportunity.
I'm encouraged by your comments, and I hope you won't let debt stop you doing what you intend to do. And so basically my last question is, do you see a further renaissance of the oil industry in Scotland?
The Chair and I talk about scenarios, and you know, I think rightly in the previous session, and it's something I'm hugely worried about. I see some very difficult scenarios potentially, and I am writing to other parts of government frequently with to share the context. Obviously, living in Aberdeen, you can't avoid it. And I am really worried. I can see some worse scenarios, frankly, than was talked about in the earlier session. I can also see some very good scenarios. Our job as a regulator is to look to the future and with different lenses and make sure, regardless of things that we can't control, like the global price of oil, we're doing everything we can to support maximising economic recovery and with that investment, and then with that, obviously, jobs. But I'm actually, at the moment, more concerned than optimistic, if truth be told.
Thank you.
Okay, I've got two members of the follow-up. Start with Chick Brody and then Gordon MacDonald.
Good afternoon. just in the context of what's been said, and what you're saying is very impressive, I'm surprised that you've gone beyond the fact that you said last month that Dick or the Change Climate Committee, that you're a regulator, but you are looking, and you've just enunciated the promotion of investment. And on that basis, what's the relationship between you and DEC? Because in another energy area, perhaps our feeling is the relationship between the regulator and DEC hasn't been as encouraging as one might hope, and they're perhaps not as assertive as you are, seem to be. What's the relationship with DEC?
The relationship is a perfectly normal one. We're the child that is getting away from the parent. But it's a very friendly relationship. We are not under pressure, in the sense, except to get on with doing what we have to do. And on the day-to-day, Andy,
There's a sponsor team within DEC that has kind of oversight of what we do, and it's a very good relationship there. Clearly, I talked about the vital legislation, both the Energy Bill and the MER UK strategy. That's a very collaborative relationship, which it needs to be. Both of those are led by DEC, but they get a lot of good input from us and vice versa. I think Patrick alluded to at the beginning, as we set ourselves up, we find that some parts of the system, for example, the supply chain seem to want us to do more than we have been set up to. So that's something that we're taking back to government to have a conversation around, because I think it's important for us that we retain focus, but also we don't want to let people down. But there are clearly other agents, other departments such as BIS, UKTI, Scottish Enterprise, who have more of a formal role in some areas than we do. What we find is, again, being based in Aberdeen, and I hope people would say generally quite good at listening, we hear the opportunities, we hear the concerns, and we try and join the dots, because I think this is an industry that it's a critical time for the industry, and I think the right leadership and the right kind of forward moves are vital.
I'm not concerned about you. It might be DEC that I'm concerned about. So that's why, you know, are there any inhibitions or hurdles that are put in place to what you obviously have a clear strategy in terms of what you're trying to achieve?
No, I think with Patrick's support, people are very happy that we need to gain the independence. Whilst industry, you know, who would like to pay the levy to fund us? I think they're realising actually that's how a apparently most other regulators funding, but it also gives them some certainty in that, you know, it's not going to be, you know, at threat down the line. And I think that maybe was the problem with DEC over the years, that, you know, the department shrunk over time. So I think the independence will protect us for the future.
Okay, thank you.
If I may, part of that independence is that apart from stuff which is really commercially confidential, we're going to be open. Things are going to be on the website. What we're doing, why we're doing it, the decisions we or Andy and his team will make and the board will approve, they'll all be there.
Thank you.
Okay. Gordon McDonald.
I wanted to go back to the point you raised earlier about the importance of data. And I noticed when you were in front of the Energy and Climate Change Committee at Westminster, you said we have recently acquired 20,000 kilometres of new data over two vast areas. I'm just wondering if you're able to say, you know, where those opportunities are and how significant you think they could be.
So that was the data over the Rockall area, mm-hmm. West of Scotland, and the Mid-North Sea High, which lies between the Southern North Sea and the Central North Sea. Mm-hmm. The Rockall is a very interesting area. There are some, you know, for such a large area and what is, you know, we always say a highly petroliferous province, the North Sea or the UKCS, compared to many parts of the world where people go exploring, we think the prospects are good. There are some wells with some very interesting shows. The next stage, though, will be to get the data interpreted, and then hopefully we'll run a licensing round, subject to those environmental assessments, and we're consulting with industry. We think the next licensing round should be targeted at these frontier areas, get some healthy competition and interest. If we're successful, companies will no doubt bid with 3D seismic, which will be the next stage there. So we think this is very important, but it's not going to be a game changer in the next 2 years, which is why we're also in parallel trying to highlight the opportunities that already lie within the basins, within licenses, the small pools, the discovered resources. Likewise, the Mid-North Sea High, there's definitely an active hydrocarbon system there. So we think the prospects are very good.
Right. And in terms of those prospects, UK Oil and Gas Operations Director recently said that there was up to 23 billion barrels of oil remaining in the UK continental shelf. So these two vast opportunities you've just highlighted, would that be an addition to the already identified up to 24 billion barrels?
We talk about a range, and our range is between 10 and over 20, actually. And it includes some element of that, certainly for the Mid-North Sea High. We're actually very keen to sharpen our estimates as we bring in people that can really leverage the data, as I talked about earlier. We think it's just the obvious next stage. So we will probably find actually the upper limit may go up actually as you get more data. I hope so. A key point of all of this though is the success, the chance of success. Because that's what industry really factor into when they're making their exploration decisions. So getting the right data and de-risking the prospects, what we tend to find is that it's not hard to come up with big numbers, but industry, for example, will be very loath to drill anything that's not a 15% or higher chance of success. So we need to help de-risk some of these plays.
Okay. John McCartan.
Thank you very much, Convener. Ian McClelland of Edison Investment Research, after the Chancellor's autumn statement, said that he feared that without short-term fiscal support, the door is closing early on much of the UK's remaining offshore reserves. And he was very critical of the fact that there weren't any fiscal announcements. And I wondered whether you had spoken to the Treasury about getting fiscal incentives into the autumn statement, particularly around exploration.
My work on fiscal matters really started actually when I was with industry. I used to be on the fiscal forum, and then the autumn statement last year, I think was a pivotal moment when the Treasury launched their driving investment plan, and in that plan was a recognition three key principles. One was that over time. The tax burden needs to fall. I think a very key second principle, which was really driven also from listening to the good work of the Scottish Expert Commission and people like Prof Kemp and Melfort Campbell, was a recognition that the value of the industry these days is often more about the supply chain and the 35 billion of turnover than just the offshore tax take. And then the third principle is it needs to be internationally competitive. At the fiscal forum this time last year, there was an agreement that the priority was the investment allowance, and there was some very good work to get that over the line for the March budget. Clearly, another priority was the overall rate of tax, and there was the 10% reduction in special corporation tax. We also worked with Treasury just to provide some evidence, and particularly around our concern of what we called the domino effect, and the fact that in the most mature parts of the basin, they were still paying the highest tax rate. And I think that had some influence over the reduction in PRT, which was a positive surprise. In terms of the autumn statement this year, I wasn't expecting anything because the driving investment plan had, you know, publicly said that we would then, or Treasury would work with industry, with support of the OGA, on the next three priorities that industry had put up, which were exploration, access to late life assets, which is a crucial one, and infrastructure. So those workshops have been going on. I think the last one will probably complete next week ahead of the fiscal forum on the 16th of December. And I think that will be an interesting conversation to see, has there been some convergence of thinking? Is there something that can be done probably for the budget next year? But that really is a matter for Treasury.
You didn't ask the Treasury for any measures in the autumn statement?
We wouldn't necessarily ask. We would provide evidence and advice.
Right.
And we haven't, you know, we haven't received anything specific. What we're doing is working through these three work groups to see what is the most important. What I would say is that certainly in exploration, which is often talked about, we think there's an awful lot of non-fiscal work that needs to happen and happen very quickly, and we're very, very focused on that, and I can expand on that.
So what about extending investment allowances to cover the costs of ageing assets?
Well, there was some good work done after the budget that was then announced in a summer statement that actually did that. So there was quite a big extension, and we provided advice on that. The intention being to promote new investment on those ageing facilities, and I think that's been well received. And I think it's we saw actually some quite substantial new investments on quite mature areas straight after the budget as well. Some companies announced some quite big investments. So I think the Treasury are absolutely on board with the fact that some of these old facilities, you know, it's not standard maintenance, it's kind of a complete overhaul. And that requires the investment allowance. So I think that principle has been established.
As I appreciate your contribution this morning. I think a lot of it's been very positive. But as Mr. McClellan said, you know, like this, there was nothing in this autumn statement, and more incentives need to be done. And I know that from Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce's review of the industry in the spring this year, 81% of contractors said that tax issues are a constraint on activity. Now, given the way that the Chancellor actually talked up the OBR's figures in terms of looking ahead in terms of the oil price, and many would say it went down very badly in Aberdeen, the mockery that the Chancellor indulged in around that, I would have thought that you would have been keen on behalf of the industry to push for measures that would give an incentive. Given the central point in his statement that the oil price played.
But what I would say is that I discuss tax very frequently when I meet with industry, and actually it's not top of their list because many of them are not paying tax. It's obviously a private matter to them and we don't see the data, but what they tell me is that regrettably that they're paying very little tax right now. So they have other asks of the OGA and of government more broadly, and that's not to diminish the importance of following through on the driving investment plan, and I think that is vital. But particularly, and we're trying to help, industry have taken the lead on this, but it's actually cost and efficiency that are the really vital work streams right now. Prof Kemp's done some brilliant analysis over many years, and I think it was last year he published that a 15% reduction in cost would be worth five times a further 10% reduction in SCT. It has a very, very substantial and positive impact on companies' economics. And we've talked earlier about standardization, and I think, you know, it's no secret that the Treasury also are intensely interested in what industry are doing to actually really grapple this. And as we've talked earlier, it's not about price reduction. This is about a transformation in how they work, and particularly how operators and the service companies work together. And, you know, so the kind of work that I'm very interested and keen to support is in trying to get those interfaces working better, although it's not my direct responsibility. I just see it as such a huge opportunity. We hear from every service company, if they can get involved with operators early in a project, they can add a lot of value through coming with, you know, solutions rather than being told what to do. People like Melford Campbell, and the chair and I met with him last week for a very good session, talks about, you know, can we get demand-led rather than relying on rather bureaucratic supply chain processes. So I do think there are some amazing opportunities for industry if they will grab them. And it's kind of obvious, actually, if you think that drilling costs have increased by 700% over 15 years. Yeah, that has to be a low-hanging fruit to address that. And there are some companies who are. And guess what? They're the ones who are maintaining or even increasing activity. And there are some companies seeing a counter-cyclical opportunity. So I do think the cost and efficiency is the most important thing, actually, right now for industry to address.
Yeah, I don't doubt there's a number of measures we can take. Just like the Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce survey showed that 81% of contractors thought tax was an issue, and you're saying that it's not an issue.
I'm not saying it's not an issue. I think the fiscal regime is always I've been very clear, actually. Before I started this job, I was asked to present, actually, at the Oil and Gas UK Annual Council, which is coming up again next week. And I looked at the slides I presented, and I had four main priorities. One was cost and efficiency. The other was getting on with wood. The third was the fiscal reform. And the fourth was leadership and, you know, transforming the industry and the culture. And I think those four priorities are as important now as they were a year ago.
And just one last question, Convener, if you'll indulge me. In the most recent Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce report that we've got today that was done with Strathclyde University, it showed that half of operators were unclear as to what your role was. Now, given that you've got a statutory role over MER, that's a problem, isn't it, if they're unclear what your role is?
I spoke to James about that this morning. I think it was half of contractors, because I think that survey is aimed at the contractors. The service company, which are not part of the MER UK obligation, actually, so they're not cited under the Infrastructure Act or the Draft Energy Bill. And as the chair alluded to earlier, there's an important question where the boundaries of the OGA remit lies. But what I said to James is we have some very good materials that I think say what we do, and I've asked him to more actively share those with his membership. I've also said, please, when you've got meetings, let us know. We'll come along, myself or one of my colleagues, and we'll very happily explain what we do, with the slight caveat that we've got a bit of work to do internally just to determine where the boundaries are. Some of my team, by the way, would like to do an awful lot more, because we see.
I'm saying no, because we have to do the key things first.
So it's just that balance, but we do see opportunities, and like I say, I think the most important one of those is what, you know, the Melford Campbell. The service sector, and particularly in the Northeast, is full of great ideas. If we can get those heard more early by the operators, that can create a lot of opportunity. They talk about plenty of low-cost, high-impact solutions, and I think that could be transformational.
Lewis McDonald.
Precisely one of the things I was keen to ask about was what your view is, and I noted your comment a few moments ago that you're currently more concerned than optimistic when you're looking at scenarios. But behind that, what is your view as to why the UK continental shelf is so high cost relative to other comparable provinces? And where are the low-hanging fruit in terms of increased collaboration and tackling those costs in order to shift from the pessimistic scenarios to the optimistic ones? What is it that industry needs to do better in order to address those costs?
So the reason that the UK is higher cost, I think the main one, kind of Mike Tholen alluded to it, and I agreed with his comment, was that we've now got 300 fields producing a third of what they used to, compared to, say, Norway, where they've got a third less fields producing quite a bit more. So just the mathematics mean that the cost per barrel goes up. I also think, and it wasn't talked about by the earlier group, but it certainly plays in my thinking, that there was a period of prolonged oil price where the service sector became massively stretched and overheated. I came back into this basin three years ago, I think it was, at the peak, and I found it very hard to get the quality of service that I had been used to when I'd worked here previously, because the whole supply chain was extremely stretched, and with that came massive inefficiency. So I think going forward, we have to retain the skills, we have to anchor what we've got, and we have to seize the opportunity. My concern is that it's a bit like an aging patient. Other basins are, and they are, and I swap notes with the Norwegians, the Alberta energy regulator I met with recently. This is a global issue, but younger basins are going to be more resilient, whereas, it's why we rushed out our report in February on the domino effect. We have this unusual situation with lots of interconnected old assets that are at threat. In terms of the solutions, standardization is massive. It is a huge opportunity. I think true collaboration, I know ASCO have come up with a simple logistics vessel sharing proposal that can save 100 million. I'm delighted now that six companies have got together and have agreed that they are going to share spares and inventory. That's a 50 million opportunity. It took them a while, but there's a good kind of cultural point here. Having spoke about it for a long time and struggled to get everyone on board, when six of them said, we're doing it, suddenly those outside the camp said, oh, we want to be in the camp. And the answer was, well, you can join in at the end of Q1 when we kind of open it up again. So I think there's a message around leadership and not trying to get everyone on board, but get groups on board and then others will quickly follow. We see lots of opportunities like that. I had a very good meeting with John Pearson, who chairs the Industry Efficiency Task Force. They have launched their rapid efficiency of change, which is where companies will share good ideas. We will support the take up of that. I think the most important thing with all of this, though, is leadership and behaviours. So I was surprised Deirdre didn't mention it, because I think it's quite good. OG UK with industry have come up with an efficiency charter. The nice thing is it's pretty simple, it's memorable, it's got five key points, standardisation is one of them. We have said that we will support that absolutely. Not with a regulatory duty, but certainly with an influencing. So I am optimistic that the cost and efficiency is an area where it can transform. I would like to see a lot more pace on it. Notwithstanding that, if oil stays at $40 for another couple of years, which is one credible scenario, that is a very grim scenario. I really hope that doesn't happen, but I'm not an expert on global geopolitics and supply and demand.
And in terms of what OGA itself does, and you've described some of that very fully, but you've also alluded to the issue where an operator is sitting on old infrastructure pipelines, for example, which they no longer have much value from, other than renting it to other operators with peripheral fields. Is there a role, an active role, for the OGA in ensuring that those networks of pipelines don't fall over because one operator or operators with mature fields no longer gain value from them? And does the model of OGA conducting seismic exploration at its own hand or commissioned at its own hand, does that model also apply to other things that can be done within the sector?
Two very good and difficult questions, actually. The first one's at the heart of the MER UK strategy and has been much debated, and I was delighted, and the chair attended the session in London also, that I think industry really appreciated the thought and drafting that had gone into the strategy, which effectively does give the OGA the power to prepare and publish a regional plan that will show, and we're doing this in a couple of areas right now because we have to, so the Northern North Sea and the Southern North Sea, trying to come up with what we think is the best regional solution. And then, of course, we can share it with operators, and if their plans don't meet our expectations, we get into the stewardship regulatory conversations and potentially have to use our powers. But I think industry are very supportive because they can see that it's in their interest, because done right, this leads to more value for everyone. A little example of done right is the operational gas group in the Northern North Sea, where companies work together in very difficult circumstances, and a lot of companies, to maximise the benefit of fuel gas, including bringing gas from Norway. That has recently got agreed, and is a nice small example of what we'd like to see a lot more going forward. But I think that the point there was that industry saw that taking a bigger picture can quite quickly create more value. On the model around, I think on we'll see, hopefully we'll be able to demonstrate real value from the 20 million investment on the seismic, and hopefully it may be something that we repeat. In terms of a more interventionist, we are asked sometimes, for example, will governments step in and take on aging infrastructure that no one else wants to operate? And I pass on those conversations to policymakers in Whitehall. I think, not surprisingly, the answer is no, because if the market doesn't want it, why would government want to pick it up? Our job is to make these things more attractive and to make the market work. So we are aware of some market failures. One of them, actually, which is crucial, is transfer of late life assets. And that's why Treasury have got that as one of the key work streams that's being worked at the moment. There are potentially some barriers, including fiscal barriers, that are stopping new companies come in and pick up and maximise value from the ageing assets. If there's one ask I tend to get from private equity, and I meet with them regularly, it's, can you try and solve that one? I'm not sure it's going to be easy. In fact, I'm sure it's not going to be easy, but we've got some very intelligent people in Treasury and elsewhere, industry, working that very hard, because I think that could be a game changer.
And one thing that I guess both Treasury and the Scottish Government might ask you about, which I asked Oil and Gas UK about a few moments ago, is the Aberdeen City Region deal, in terms of the industry, its ability to plan for the future. Is that something that you as a regulator will comment on if asked by government, either Scottish or UK government?
Yes.
What should happen?
We've been working very closely with Scottish Enterprise, particularly on the technology and innovation part of it. They've been extremely interested in the work that we're leading with industry on the Technology Leadership Board, because that's seen as a precursor. We've provided some value cases, which, needless to say, the value is extremely high. And I think that's very useful in support of the city, region and deal. We would like to see the overall business case, but we wrote a letter of support, caveated to obviously needing to see the business case, which is being worked, because we do think this is a good thing. And we think, you know, more broadly, there are some fantastic skills across the UKCS, but obviously in the Northeast. And it's back to creating the right conditions, anchoring those skills and maximising the export opportunity as well.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I think we've got time for just one last question from Dennis Robertson.
Thanks very much, Convener. With regard to the skills and projection to the future, are you concerned at the moment that there may be the possibility that we could lose some of that skilled workforce, and the opportunity after exploration and with the mature fields required to close, and we've got decommissioning, which is extremely valuable? Are you concerned that the skills may not be there? And do you have a role to try and encourage companies to retain that skill for the future? And do you have a strategic plan for decommissioning?
Three very big questions.
Well, it was only a short question.
I am concerned. I was concerned from day one of my job. I was concerned even before I started my job. So we formalised our concern in our call to action report in February. Since then, I've been very active on the Scottish Energy Jobs Task Force, which has been a pleasure to contribute to, and I think it has been a very good task force, I have to say. And the bit I've done particularly on there is working with others is on the values and principles and recently we've been asked to take on the leadership bit as well, potentially. More specifically, though, when we meet with companies, and we've done this at pilot dinners and every opportunity we have, we ask them, what are they doing? And notwithstanding the difficult economic situation they're facing, they are looking to retain graduate schemes, apprenticeships, where possible. They understand the importance of that. We obviously highlight our appreciation of that and our support for that. My HR director has gone further as a subgroup of the Scottish Energy Jobs Task Force. He's working transfer opportunities, anything we can do just to kind of anchor and keep them. I think the kind of ideas that Bob Keeler's talked about publicly are very good ideas. So we support all of that, and both sides of the border. So we also have a role to highlight the gravity of the situation and some opportunities with colleagues in BIS and UKTI. And we have a very good relationship with them as well.
Just on the decommissioning, I wonder.
Oh, yeah, decommissioning. So Sirian in the Wood Review called for a single decommissioning body, because he recognised, notwithstanding our primary role to keep things going and maximise the economic recovery, there comes a time when, you know, decommissioning is the right thing for a particular set of assets. There was quite a plethora of different bodies involved. We've worked with them to and got agreement to form the single decommissioning kind of senior board. They've got their first meeting, I think, this week, which will then report into the MER UK forum. One of my key asks is to take a strategic approach. We are not waiting for that. We've been doing quite a lot. So in the southern North Sea, we found that there were 8 operators decommissioning 500 wells. Getting them to work together has led to a 40% cost saving. But I think more strategically, it is a great opportunity for the service sector. As was remarked on the previous session, it could be an international competitive advantage if done right. I think the first thing that where we can help is actually being very transparent about what's coming up. Because I think in the past, the service sector heard about it, but then it never came. So they kind of said, well, is this a real opportunity or is it something that just gets being pushed back? I think we have an authoritative position that can actually publish, and we have done a draft of that in our draft corporate plan, our best estimate of what's coming up and when. We know that some organisations such as the Aberdeen Harbour are very interested in that as they look at potential expansion plans and look to see this as a good opportunity going forward. So I think the transparency of data is a no-brainer. I think getting operators to work together and phase their approach is a no-brainer. Taking due attention of changes in regulation, OSPAR and the like, is vital. There are massive opportunities and some threats for the industry. So we feel we have a role to kind of scan that forward horizon. We've also flagged this as an opportunity to the cross-party select committee. This is under the last parliament, they were particularly focused on local content. We've suggested that actually for this next parliament, obviously that remains a vital consideration, but we've flagged that we think decommissioning could be a really good topic for that group, and they agree. So hopefully that group will kind of get up and running as well. So I think there's quite a lot we can do, but there's, you know, it's a strategy that's being formulated actively right now.
Thank you.
Right, thank you. I think that's us out of our time. Thank you very much to you both, Mr. Samuel and Sir Patrick, for coming and answering our questions this morning. It's been very useful. And at this point, we will suspend briefly and go into private session.